Good morning, Interweb. Let's world build. Different languages sound different, right? But why is that? Well, many reasons, but what if I told you geography may be an important one? What if I told you the Earth itself may influence how human languages sound? You'd probably think I'm crazy, but trust me, you ain't seen nothing yet. Beatboxing, the art of physically assaulting vegetables at its core, utilizes three unique sounds, pt and k. Beatboxers call these the bass, hi-hat and snare sounds. Linguists, however, call them ejectives. I'm not going to go into the sound production mechanics here because it's super dry and super boring and would involve me using words like stylohyoid and digastric. Words that are entirely too nerdy, even for me. Instead, let's turn to the fine city of Topeka, Kansas. Only let's hold our breaths and without exhaling, pronounce the word Topeka, placing particular emphasis on each consonant. Ready? Here we go. There you have it, three eloquently engineered ejectives. Fun game, go through the regular pulmonic consonants and see which of them can be ejectivized using this method. Some will be easy, others will be difficult, and others still will be impossible. Give it a try and let me know in comments why you think that is. Now, despite being utilized by 100% of beatboxers, ejectives only feature in about 20% of the world's languages. The Quechua word for clothes is pacha. The Kabardian word for ram is tuh. The Hausa word for effort is kukari, and so on. If we plot all ejective languages on a world map, we get something that looks a little like this. Pretty random, right? Wrong. Noticeable clustering is evident in several locations, but what's really surprising is that this clustering correlates almost perfectly with five of the world's six major high-altitude regions. The North American Cordillera, the Andes, the South African Plateau, the East African Rift, and the Caucasus. The linguist Dr. Caleb Everett suggested this correlation is direct evidence supporting the notion that geography can drive language evolution. The idea being that decreased air pressure at high altitude makes ejectives easier to pronounce. The force required to produce an ejective like ka at an altitude of 2,500 meters is 26% less than at sea level. Additionally, he theorizes that ejectives may help reduce water vapor loss. Humans typically lose between 300 and 400 milliliters of water vapor daily through exhaled breath. But ejectives don't require exhalation. Remember, they are non-pulmonic sounds. We can produce them with our breaths held. Reduce the amount you exhale while speaking and you reduce your water vapor loss, which would help combat dehydration and altitude sickness. All pretty advantageous stuff if you live high in the mountains. Now, to be clear, it's not like if you moved from the suburbs to the summit of Everest, you'd suddenly begin speaking with ejectives. Rather, high altitude languages may just be more likely to develop and hold on to ejective sounds. Now, Everett certainly isn't the only one who has studied such linguistic correlations. Papers have been written linking temperature, humidity, mountainous regions, and even plant cover to aspects of language such as sonority and tone. Sonority, by the way, is just a measure of the loudness of a sound. Vowels tend to be louder than voiceless plosives, and a general hierarchy, at least for English, looks something like this. Loud to soft. These studies have shown that languages native to warm regions tended to be overall more sonorous than those native to cold regions. Warm equals louder, cold equals softer. The justification being that people in warm climates tend to spend more time outside and so have a greater need to communicate at a distance. The louder a speech segment is, the more audible it is at a distance. Thus, it is advantageous for warm climate languages to trend towards increased sonority. People in cold climates, especially cold mountainous regions, have to contend with freezing temperatures and wind chill. Louder, more sonorous sounds require a speaker to open their mouths more. Compare ah and e. In general, the less of your insides you expose to the cold, the better, so lowering the overall sonority in these cases is a good thing. Dense plant cover in warm regions results in people communicating at shorter distances, so here we see a trend towards decreased sonority. In cold regions, dense vegetation has the opposite effect. It reduces wind chill, so we see an increase in sonority. Now, humidity comes into play with tonal languages like Cantonese and Mandarin. Complex tonal systems require very precise articulation of the vocal cords. In cold, dry climates, this precision is difficult to achieve. We need to have a bit of moisture in the air to lube up those vocal folds and get them working at peak efficiency. As a result, we tend to only find complex tonal languages in and around warm, humid regions. Now, this all sounds awesome, but things start to come unraveled when we look at implosives, the sister sound of ejectives. If you've ever imitated someone drinking a bottle of water by making a glugging sound, you've come close to producing an implosive. To a good approximation, if you glug a B, you'll get a voiced bilabial implosive. ba, a ba. Glug a D and you've a voiced alveolar implosive. Da, a da. And so on. Like before, I'd encourage you to see which of the standard pulmonic consonants can and can't be implosivized. And I'd encourage you to ask why that is. Anyways, if we plot all the implosive featuring languages, we again see a lot of clustering, perhaps even more so than with ejectives. And I'm pretty sure given a free afternoon or two, I could come up with some sort of correlation to account for this. And therein lies a fundamental problem with all these studies. Correlation does not necessarily imply causation. I'm not saying these studies are garbage, or that we should ignore them, or that they're correct. Rather, it's our job to test the hypotheses put forward in these studies, chuck out the bad ones, and come up with a good theory that accurately describes the state of the universe. So does the Earth itself influence how we speak? Maybe? Though a lot more testing is needed. Now, when it comes to the construction of languages in genre fiction, these studies can be quite useful. Their results could make for some pretty interesting creative constraints. Like, say you're thinking of shooting an unimaginative reworking of Pocahontas and you want to create a badass language for your giant smurfs to speak. Ask yourself, what environment will this language be spoken in? Is altitude a factor? Temperature? Plant cover? Terrain? Can I use the environment to drive my language construction? If nothing else, these studies, in the context of genre fiction, can and should stop people creating the dreaded kitchen sink conlang. And for that alone, they have their value.
So it's quickly become my thing where I ridicule various works of fiction in my videos. First there's Harry Potter, and now there's Avatar, and who knows what else in the future. Now, but with Avatar, it's pretty easy going because there's a lot wrong with that film. It is, by all accounts, fairly mediocre. What is not mediocre, however, is the Na'vi language. Na'vi is a beautifully constructed fictional language. If you have any interest in conlangs, check that language out. It's well worth it. Also, I've been getting a lot of comments recently and I just need to clarify things. Artifexian is equal parts geofiction and language construction. That is, there will be a geofiction video and then a language construction video, and then a geofiction video and then a language construction video, and we'll proceed like that. It kind of works well for me and I hope you guys enjoy it too. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed this video. Click the links on screen or in the description for more Artifexian content. Like, and if you think I earned it, hit the subscribe button. Thank you all so much for watching. Edgar out.